Hello everybody, it's Licky Giraffe here with part 5 of my Dark Souls playthrough. So, in the last part, what do? We defeated the gargoyles, just. And that was really, really fun. So now we are off to... Actually, one thing I want do is I want to try and go defeat Havel now, because I'm getting a little heavy and I want to see, and his rig is really, really good for my kind of build because it lets me move a little bit more grace. So I'm going to try out the Zyhander on my way over, and say by the time I make it over there I will hopefully know which between the Zyhander and the Claymore I actually prefer using. So let's run up here. Do. Womp. Ooh, firebomb, sweet. Oh no. So yeah, Zyhander definitely does more damage, a little bit slower though, and I think if I was to go use the Claymore, it would be because Zyhander is a little bit too slow, but we will see how we go. Run through here. Another one of the things I really enjoy about this game is that it encourages backtracking. I love backtracking. You know, for example, as you're running through an area, you come across locked doors, you come across inaccessible areas. So after you finish the area, you're like, oh, you know, it's great now, I finished the area, but... You know, there's some stuff I wasn't able to do back there. And then when you find like a new key or some environmental thing happens, then you go, if you've been paying attention, you'll hopefully remember, oh, cool, hold on a second. Maybe that'll, or, oh, the description of this key, it will allow me to go back to this area that I was in previously and like open this door. Oh, I wonder what's behind here. And whoops. Careful now, I don't want to get overwhelmed. God, that uses like all of my stamina. Also increased range, another benefit of the Zyhander. Ah, jeez, what am I doing? Ah! I apologize, everyone. What was I talking about? Oh yeah, the backtracking, and so that really encourages exploration, encourages players to go back to areas that they've been previously. Excuse me. Go back to areas they've been previously, and oh, I forgot about that shortcut actually. Go back to areas they've been previously, and would it actually be quicker to go up? I'm just trying to think. It would be a little quicker, wouldn't it? Let's carry on. Encourages exploration. Gosh darn. Encourages exploration, and it fosters, well, it helps foster a... what's the word I'm looking for? Helps foster a certain attitude amongst the player. You know, if suddenly, you know, upon suddenly getting that key, they can access this area. They've been wondering, it's like, oh, I wonder what's behind here. Oh, I found a new item. This new area, that's really cool. I wonder what the description is. And there's all that hidden lore in Dark Souls as well that you can completely ignore if you want. But for those kind of players who really like that sort of thing. Actually, inside. From players who really, really enjoy that sort of thing. It can be really, really fun. Because there is so much lore in Dark Souls, and it is all really hidden away. It is all really hidden away, and you really have to go looking, and it doesn't explain everything. As I suppose the Dark Souls way, it doesn't explain any, like, everything. You get pieces, and it's up to the player to be able to put those pieces together and form a cohesive backstory with them, which is really nice. It's really refreshing way to I guess reward the players, the exploration slash kind of narrative players who really enjoy that sort of thing. And if you've been watching me for the last few parts, you probably realize I'm not that interested in the lore. For example, like, I don't open up every item I get and read what's in it. Take that. It's just not my personal cup of tea. Like, I enjoy kind of reading the odd tidbit, but I wouldn't be the kind of player who actively seeks it out. Okay, let's see now. I'm going to get like a potion and send. One more down. Run. Yes. Okay, wish me luck. I've managed to do this every single playthrough. So hopefully this one will be... Okay, not a great start. Oh dear. Okay. I just need to get into the swing of things. It's fine. It'll be fine. Havel, you dog. That really hurt. Well, it really hurt my stamina. I feel like the claymore may actually be better for this. Because the Zyhander is quite slow. Trying to get those backstabs off on him. It would be good if I could. Oh, there's one. Haha. Didn't even do that much. Darn his powerful armor. Oh well, I suppose if I do just have to stand here and backstab him, I suppose the Zyhander will be slightly better. Actually, I want to get him away from that stairwell because I can't get around him if he's over there. Oh, taking advantage of some indecision there by Havel. Okay, it's on what, halfway? Of course, it can all be over in a second, as if you've tried to fight him before, you will know that one misstep will spell my doom. Oh, down he goes. So for him to run back up. Come to us. Do 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 do. Whack. Because that club hits really hard, and the tracking on it is not too bad as well. So you really have to be pretty far away from him when he attacks, or else that happens. See, now he's backed up against there, so I want to draw him out a little bit. Get him to... I've had him downtown to this health a few times now in previous playthroughs, and I've messed up. I've gotten cocky or I've done something stupid. And he has smushed me, and it is the most frustrating thing, I suppose, with any Dark Souls boss. But it's just any sort of mistake with Havel, because he just hits so darn hard. So like things like that, where just tracking just goes a bit wonky, and it's very difficult to determine like where. Actually go. See, I'm taking quite a lot of hits now, and I don't like that because it is scary. He's being a real annoying jerk. And oh, could this be it? Yes! Haha! Havel is defeated! First time! Dang. I'm telling you guys, putting this up on YouTube has imbued this playthrough with I don't know, some sort of luck modifier. Defeating the gargoyles like I did, and now I managed to defeat Havel on the first turn. It's wonderful. So see that I used my master key, which is the key I picked up. It lets you go some places where I think technically you're not allowed to go. Well, the game would rather you not go. But it lets you get to go there anyway, which is pretty cool. We won't actually go here quite yet, so we're going to run back. But the Master Key is really interesting though, because it lets you break the critical path that the developers laid out for the player. When I say critical path, I mean the most optimum path through the game. Which the developers control using gating methods. So like you have the keys, you have the doors, you have levers, you have powerful bosses. All those combine to force, so, and even the level design, all combine to force the player down a particular route. No, this is where we defeated. Actually, another fairly lucky victory now that I think about it. I'll just kill these guys on the firing at me. I'll kind of push the player down a particular path, and that does a very useful thing, because it allows the developers of the game, the level designers, to say, oh well, if we follow this critical path, then we can estimate that the player will be roughly this strong when they get to this point, or they will have, say, these keys or these magical items by this point. And it's a really, really useful tool in planning. It's a tool I use quite an awful lot when I'm planning my Dungeons & Dragons adventures, because otherwise it would be very hard to try and plan. Like how difficult do I want this encounter to be? How many like enemies will make this a hard challenge or like an easy challenge? Can I assume that the players have this item before they go down into fight this enemy where they need the item? Let me think. I'll just keep going. I'll use the basement key. Which will take a little bit of searching if I can remember. My first time I took a while to search before I could figure out where I could use this key. But here we are. So I'll go down here. Haha. And that also, so what the master key does, is it essentially lets the player go off the beaten track. So it allows more flexibility, but on the downside, you can potentially go get into areas that are, say, far higher level than you, or go into places where you don't have a magical item that you need, for example. And you just get killed, but Dark Souls lets you make those mistakes if you want. You know, so it offers you the master key, you can do with it what you want. There is the another little shortcut for us, because we were untold when we opened it, and star doors bar from the other side. Oh, we have some enemies. Actually, in that whole door bar from the other side thing, very useful gating mechanism to use in a game, because you know it's a very easy one. It's like, oh, there's a door barring your progress. It's blocked from the other side. You must find the key and move on. And it's nice and simple. Not so simple in D&D, mainly because in Dark Souls you're limited by the actions the programmers gave you. Whereas in D&D, there are no constraints. So for example, you can't just put a barred gate. Well, you can't just put a rusty gate that just happens, whoops, to be locked from the other side in front of the players and expect them to, not give up without a fight, I suppose. So for example, you know, a strong character could try, like, bend the bars of the door, which is entirely possible, especially if they're rusted. A wizard or a mage could have a spell that like bends metal or unlocks the lock. They could try and blow it up. There's a near limitless supply of potential things the players can do. This is locked, isn't it?
Somebody help me! Unlock the door. Damn, I'm finished.
Now actually, Maria, I need to go buy that key. So gating in that sense is a little bit harder with D&D because of the breadth of options available to a player. And so when you're doing gating in D&D, it requires it requires a slightly greater degree of thought, because you need to try and figure out at what the levels the players will have certain abilities. So for example, I know 5th edition D&D, a wizard gets the unlock spell, or like the arcane locker, whatever it is, at like level 500 or something. So at that point you could have like a locked door, like a sturdy locked door guarding some area, and you could be reasonably confident that the players, like, they could give it a try, and then if they discovered that it was too much of a pain, they would just leave it and carry on. Whereas if you presented that same situation at a later level, then the wizard could simply be like, oh, I will just use this unlock spell on unlock the door, and your gate has, well, not failed, but it hasn't worked as you had intended to. Which can be a bit of a pain. But on the other hand, if players do try and say break the critical path, or they try really hard to open the door that, you know, obviously seems to be really well locked, then you know, you shouldn't need to try and scamper to try and... Oh no, parry me. Oh dear. Ow. That was my fault. Shouldn't need to try scamper and make everything really, really easy. Or I'll say tone it down for them, for example. Just because they've gotten through the gate and now suddenly they're in an area that is, you know, far too high of a difficulty for them. Instead... What a good idea is you should present them with, say, the challenge you had in place, like, say, a mighty foe or something else, and, say, through the narrative, describe how they're going to get really messed up if they don't get out of there. You know, for example, this foe is clearly beyond you, or one more hit will surely be the end of you. Because, and again, I'm kind of talking through some of the points that Angry GM made, in that a lot of players aren't too familiar with the idea of retreating or surrendering when the odds look very bleak. They go into a fight with the mindset of, we need to kill these guys before they kill us, and will throw themselves at an enemy until they are suddenly at zero hit points and they have fallen unconscious. Now their party is eyeing down a total party kill. And so it's important for them to learn that. And then there should be as well, there should be points in any adventure perhaps where the adventurers are faced with a challenge that they can't, well, not can't possibly, but there should always be a chance, but should prove extremely difficult to overcome, and that they should either retreat and go another way, or alternatively, they could retreat and then come back at a later stage, because it tells the players that it's okay to lose. I suppose it's okay to retreat. Retreat is a viable option, and I think that's pretty important. Pretty important lesson to learn. Actually, hold up 2 seconds. See, I'm not actually enjoying the Zyhander that much. I just feel it just feels slightly too slow for my liking. So I'm going to change back to the Claymore for now. It's got a shorter range, sure, but I really enjoy the quicker attack. Anyway, let me think. 7,000 souls. No, let's not go to that fog gate yet. And again, another Dark Souls, again, reinforcing the lesson. Do not charge head first. Always check the areas that you cannot see. I think that is one of the few times that I've ever, managed to get the second R2 attack off without missing. Bandit knife, cool. Let me think. One over here. Yeah, we can't open that yet. Go over to this guy. Pick him up. Gee, wow, 7,000 souls. While I was rambling on, I did not realize how many souls I had. I think I didn't die. Pop through here.
You still have your senses about you. Then why won't you buy?
Some of my moss. Talk. Forest. Triple in. Again, notice that laugh as well, the vee-hee-hee. Reinforcing that kind of. She's not gonna attack me, but is she really, really crazy? I curse him with bone. Nothing too interesting there. Trim lad, you are. Ha ha ha. If we run down here, run. Actually, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to. We'll wait till we get to the end of this tunnel. So, end of this tunnel, open, and now. Dun 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 dun! Back to Firelink. Whoops. Oh no! Aha! Foolish me. Where is it gonna drop me? Okay, this is alright, this is okay. We can very carefully fight our way back to the Firelink Shrine. Everything is going to be okay, and I will not lose those 7,000 souls. Woe is me. I just had to attack that guy and fall off that ledge. I've been down there. Yeah. Nope. Take that, you foul cadavers. Also, did what I was going to say this. Not sure when the next one of these is going to be, mainly because, Total War Warhammer is out tomorrow, and I've been looking forward to that game for a very long time, so I will probably be playing that pretty, thank god there are muscles, sweet, so I will probably be playing that for most of my free time in the coming weeks. Not that I don't love Dark Souls and I'm really enjoying this playthrough thus far, but oh man, I swear this guy is just trying to wreck my day. Okay, I'm gonna get off this dangerous ridge. Total Warhammer. Looking forward to it for a very long time, so you must excuse me while I play that for a good long while. Actually, that's something I might do. I might stream, or I might, depending on how well I'm able to run it, I may look to record my playthroughs of that. I haven't decided who I'm going to be playing, actually. As my very first campaign. I'm thinking either Empire or Dwarves. Oof, okay. Right, I'm gonna turn myself human again. Oof. And I'm gonna spend my souls. Woo. Okay. Ooh, actually, I'm trying to think. I'm gonna leave a few souls so that we can go to the blacksmith at the start of the next video. That's something I want to do. Oh. Can only afford one. Oh well. Go to endurance, and then I will gobble some souls. Soul lost undead. Level up. And give my vitality a bit of a boost. Okay, cool. We'll finish up there. Thanks very much for watching, guys, and I will see you for part 6. Thank you very much.